It all started in 1922. Things were a little different than they are today. Here are a few facts and top headlines from our nation and around the world to bring everyone back in time to that era. This is when Lawrence Finley Killick, Jr. was born in Burlington, Vermont, hereafter affectionately referred to as Dad. Sports were a very early part of development in the Killick household. Dad and his younger brother Tommy were always outside playing every sport imaginable. They really enjoyed watching their hometown University of Vermont athletes compete in baseball, basketball, and football, one day hoping to play college ball themselves. Their father, Lawrence Finley Killick, known as Whitey, was an administrator at the school and also on the local school board. Other than his love of education, Grandpa enjoyed sports radio announcing. Here he is interviewing world heavyweight boxing champion Jack Dempsey. Both Uncle Tommy and Dad received some of their toughest critiques by my grandfather, who tried to be fair balanced while broadcasting all their games for a local CBS affiliate. Dad made the Burlington High junior varsity basketball team as a 10th grader, even though he was only 14. He's holding the trophy after they won the district championship. Dad played varsity the next 2 years, and Uncle Tommy was their team helper. They lost by 2 points in the state championship game his senior year. After a year of prep school and a lot of growing, Dad came home in 1940 to play 2 outstanding years of basketball for UVM. He was All-State both years and set a single-game scoring record of 37 points at UVM his sophomore year that was not broken for 63 years. Before his junior year, the war had begun, and in July 1943, he volunteered to join the Marines. He learned how to be a soldier at Parris Island, Camp Lejeune, Quantico, and Camp Pendleton. During that time, he continued to play basketball to one day return home and play again after the war was over. That same year, the Navy had established the largest V-12 base in the country on the Dartmouth campus. This allowed the students to get enlisted military and officers training while continuing their education for 3 more semesters before going to fight overseas. With the influx of military trainees, there was added basketball talent that contributed to the fortunes of the Dartmouth team 1943-44. That team acquired the best record in Dartmouth history by going 14-3. They made it to the NCAA Finals against Utah and lost in overtime with 4 of their 5 starters recently transferred overseas since their training was complete. One of them was my dad. He became a rifle platoon leader and was shipped to the island of Guam in the Pacific Theater to shore up the fight against the Japanese. My Uncle Tommy had just graduated from Burlington High School in 1943, All-State in baseball. After graduation, he also signed up to become a Marine like his older brother. Making the best of their time on Guam, the Marines used the disarmed Japanese prisoners of war to help them build a basketball court. They started a Navy Marines Central Pacific Basketball League using transport planes to get military teams to and from the islands. His team became the champions of the Central Pacific League. Also, to make things feel more like home on Guam, a Burlington friend built a Vermont maple syrup factory on the island. The locals loved the new delicacy. Everybody helped in the war effort. Even Henry Fonda was overseas in the military, while Bob Hope was also there entertaining the troops. Finally, the war ended, and Uncle Tommy made it home safely, enrolled at Dartmouth, and had a nice baseball career there. He's on the front left side of this picture. He graduated in 1947. Dad also made it back home and decided to finish up his college career at UVM. He was voted captain of the basketball team and had a fantastic senior year, with the best record ever achieved in UVM history at 19-3. He was voted an All-American and invited to represent the East in the NCAA Collegiate All-Star Game, played in New York at Madison Square Gardens. Dad was the talk of New England basketball. A respected sports columnist once wrote, and I quote, "Larry has few peers as a passer. He throws them fast and accurate to a teammate that you would swear wasn't within his vision. While apparently watching a cute blonde in the third row, Killick will whip the ball over and behind him to a mate cutting for the basket on the other side of the court. Sometimes the destination of the pumpkin is so deceiving that it hits unsuspecting mates on the noggin. You cannot blame Larry for those happenstances, however." Unquote. Dad was drafted by the Baltimore Bullets and now enjoyed playing against the teams he idolized growing up as a kid. Dad had a really nice game against the Celtics and was strangely congratulated by his teammates. During Christmas time in 1949, tragedy struck. His brother Tommy was killed in a car accident in Chicago, coming home from his new school, the American Institute of Foreign Trade in Phoenix, Arizona. Tommy had survived the war, and yet at age 24, he was buried 3 days before Christmas. Dad was devastated. In his honor, my middle brother was named after him. Not long after the death of Tommy, he left the NBA to organize basketball clinics for kids with his friends Bob Cousy and Bill Sharman. In 1955, Dad was asked to be an ambassador by the U.S. State Department to promote goodwill throughout the world by touring with the 1955 NBA champion Syracuse Nationals as a player coach and teaching the game of basketball to the people of Europe, North Africa, and the Middle East. This ball player on the left is palming the ball with just his pinky and thumb. Dad had found his calling, helping kids learn how to play basketball and seeing the world at the same time. While on his tour teaching basketball, Dad realized that the goal at 10 feet was too high for the younger kids to shoot correctly with good form. He started thinking about how to create a lower hoop that would attach to a regulation size goal. His first entrepreneurial foray was little kid basketball. It's very antiquated by today's standards, but this was the first adjustable goal for kids. The LK logo stood for Little Kid and Larry Killick. He got all his friends to endorse his product, including the infamous Jackie Robinson, Brooklyn Dodgers great who broke the color barrier in professional baseball, basketball greats Celtic Bob Cousy, and St. Louis All-Star Mighty Ed McCauley. In 1969, Dad was elected to the University of Vermont Sports Hall of Fame, a charter member of the first six inductees covering its previous 178-year school history. In 1999, Dad was selected by Sports Illustrated magazine as one of the 50 greatest sports figures of the century from Vermont, along with the 50 greatest from each of the other 49 states. Also in 1999, Dad found letters he had written to his parents every day during the war. It brought back vivid memories and allowed him, at 77 years old, to write his memoirs entitled Boots, Troops, and Hoops. Lastly, in 2006, at the age of 84, Dad was inducted into the New England Basketball Hall of Fame, alongside of such basketball greats as Bob Cousy, Rick Pitino, Patrick Ewing, Julius Erving, and a host of others. Now, getting back to 1957, Dad moved to New York, had a bachelor pad, and was having fun with his buddy, the Coos. Dad was a wild animal, not looking to be tamed by that someone special who stole his heart. He started working as the public relations director at Mosler Safe Company and met a coworker named Rhoda Hershoff. Our life began with the twinkle in Dad's eye once he met Mom. Thank you, Dad, for the unforgettable memories that will live on inside all of us and for the wonderful world you help make a better place to live for generations to come.
Unforgettable, that's what you are. Unforgettable, though near or far. like a song of love that clings to me. How the thought of you does things to me. Never before has someone been more unforgettable in every way. And forevermore, that's how you'll stay. That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
What a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? Saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They learn much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Ooh, yeah.
And now the end is near. So I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway. And more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do. Saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this,
I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was darkness, my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say. It was my...